In the East San Gabriel Valley and Whittier area, the name Turnbull Canyon conjures up tales of mystery, myth, and urban legends. We've all heard the stories of evil cults, Hell's Gate, and even that mysterious plane crash. But there's a forgotten tale that no one ever looks into. Where did the name Turnbull come from?
Most places are named after notable leaders or community founders, but not Turnbull Canyon. Turnbull Canyon was named after a Scottish immigrant who witnessed the end of the William Workman era and the beginning of the Whittier era. He was also a town drunk who was murdered. And with all the urban legends that surround the canyon, somehow that seems fitting.
In 1873, a Scotsman named Robert Turnbull came to California because he saw hope and opportunity for a new life in the United States. Robert had been a shepherd, but his dream was to make a fortune in real estate. He bought his first patch of land in LA near the Macy Street Bridge. Today, that bridge is called the Cesar Chavez Bridge, and it's here that Robert Turnbull called home. During a time of evolution in the city's history, Robert became a true Angeleno. Around town, he was known as a local character. With a thick Scottish accent, he stood out like a sore thumb. And between his drinking problem and his big mouth, Turnbull always seemed to land himself into trouble. Not even his closest friends had ever seen him sober. I don't think Robert cared what people thought of him, because he certainly didn't let this stop him from moving real estate. And by 1875, Turnbull had already put away over $6,000 into the Temple Workman Bank in Los Angeles. Two men owned this bank, William Workman and his son-in-law, F.P.F. Temple. William Workman was an old-timer and living legend in these parts. He was an adventurer, rancher, and businessman. Plus, he owned much of the eastern San Gabriel Valley, nearly 49,000 acres, or as he called it back then, the Rancho La Puente. When it came to the bank, William was a hands-off silent partner, whereas his son-in-law, Francis, was more involved in the day-to-day running of the bank. The banking house of Temple and Workman was popular in the 1870s, but largely for the wrong reasons. Temple's lending policy was relaxed, and the bank was poorly managed by its head cashier. Furthermore, the bank's investments in a wide range of projects were dangerously depleting cash reserves, especially after the state's economy collapsed in 1875. When news of the crash reached Los Angeles, a panic broke out. Everybody wanted their money, and they wanted it now. Unable to meet the demand for cash, Temple and Workman suspended business for 30 days and desperately tried to figure out a way to stay in business and avoid bankruptcy. They had to swallow their pride and go to a relatively new landowner and tycoon in the area, Elias J. Lucky Baldwin. Based out of San Francisco, he was a shrewd businessman who was investing in the Los Angeles area real estate market. Workman was an old man and wasn't up for the trip, so Temple went alone. Baldwin was holding all of the cards and put demands on the loan that were virtually impossible to meet. Left with no options, Temple felt he had to take a chance and accept the offer. With a loan for over $340,000, Workman and Temple reopened by throwing a lavish banquet with all the trimmings. This was probably an attempt to make things look better than they really were, but people knew the situation and wanted to get their accounts closed. Plus, it was Christmas. Within a month, the depositors quietly drained the institution dry of its borrowed funds. Out of money and out of options, Temple and Workman closed the bank forever in January of 1876. Four months later, on May 17th, William Workman was visited by Richard Garvey, a court receiver and associate of Lucky Baldwin's. Garvey had come to deliver a legal notice informing Workman that his property was being put into assignment. This meant that Baldwin could foreclose on all of Mr. Workman's property, including his beautiful Rancho La Puente. William Workman was bewildered by these events he had no part in shaping. With a single signature, Workman had signed away his life's work. With the documents in his possession, Garvey tipped his hat and walked away. Shaken, numb, and now penniless, an ailing workman quietly went inside his home, loaded his revolver, and took his own life. William Workman was 76 years old. An advisory committee consisting of the bank's largest creditors had been formed, and Robert Turnbull was reluctantly appointed as one of its members. This committee had to make a decision: force the bank into bankruptcy or work under assignment. The latter was chosen in the hope that it would return some money to its creditors. However, it's highly unlikely that anyone got any of their money back. Where most people saw tragedy and loss, Robert Turnbull saw opportunity. Because he was on the advisory committee, he knew he could buy land for cheap. Lying within the Puente Hills was a canyon that he purchased for next to nothing. It was occupied by sheep and a stream of water. And as long as the sheep's wool turned a profit, Turnbull would keep this canyon. The canyon extended west from the former Rancho La Puente and into an area known then as the Thomas Ranch. In early 1885, two Quaker men named Aquila Pickering and Jonathan Bailey were searching California for an adequate piece of land to start a new Quaker colony. Pickering, Bailey, and their friends were shown the quiet Thomas Ranch. From the first, the Quakers were all favorably impressed with this beautiful situation. The high ground sloping away from the Puente Hills, from which they can see the entire valley reaching towards the ocean. It was in that moment that the Quakers decided that this would be the ideal spot for their new settlement. The Pickering Land and Water Company was created, and the Quakers began to buy up the land. But they still didn't have access to water. The key to their problem was Robert Turnbull. His canyon contained the water needed to start a new settlement. The problem was, Robert Turnbull wasn't interested in selling. Nothing would convince him to sell his land, nor could they name a price that seemed to satisfy him. For the next 2 years, the two Quaker men would continue to make offers, and they would continue to be shot down by the stubborn Scotsman. Bailey and Pickering had their hands full with Turnbull. On June 7th, 1887, Bailey and Pickering invited Robert Turnbull to meet about the canyon. Turnbull wasn't a proper gentleman like the Quakers, and was probably nervous. I suspect Robert knew this would be their final offer. And even though Turnbull wasn't interested in selling the canyon, he wasn't one to turn away a bid either. After 2 years of pursuing Turnbull in his canyon, the Quakers were starting to think he would never sell and were beginning to look into other water resources. Plus, they were aware the canyon was a source of income for Mr. Turnbull, and if the Quakers were serious about the canyon, they needed to up their offer. Jonathan Bailey pled their case to Turnbull, then offered to buy the canyon for $30,000. Robert had never before been offered such a large amount of money for a single piece of land. That's nearly half the price the Quakers paid for the entire uptown area. Robert Turnbull accepted. He and his new Quaker friends shook hands as they reached a deal. In the early days, the founding Quakers frowned upon drink. So Whittier was probably not a town Robert Turnbull would have wanted to own property in anyway. Their Quaker settlement was now complete. They could begin to subdivide the land and bring water to the people. And although this group of Quakers were already calling the area Whittier, it would be another decade before the Pickering Land and Water Company would officially name the town after the famous Quaker poet, John Greenleaf Whittier. On Wednesday, January 18th, 1888, Robert had gone out for a few drinks at his favorite watering hole, the St. Charles Hotel in Los Angeles. And even though Robert was drunk and walking sideways, it was time to go home. He managed to begin his ride, but along the way, Robert passed out and fell off of his horse. A Los Angeles police officer witnessed this, and he arrested him for public drunkenness. The next morning, Turnbull was released from jail, and by the looks of him, he'd been beaten up badly. His housekeeper, Mary Cape, could see that Turnbull was injured, but Robert insisted that he wasn't hurt and wanted to be left alone. However, Turnbull's broken, bruised, and bloodied face told a very different story. Henry Fenton was Robert's good friend and heard that Turnbull took a fall from his horse. Robert explained that he was taken to jail after his fall. He thought maybe he'd been talking too much, so someone must have knocked him out to shut him up. Henry was worried about his friend and pleaded with Robert to clean up his act, explaining that Turnbull's drinking was killing him. But Robert didn't want to be lectured and asked to be left alone. That evening, while Mary Cape was preparing dinner, Turnbull awoke. And according to Miss Cape, something was off. He seemed out of sorts. Not drunk, but not himself. He had on carpet slippers, 2 to 3 vests, a striped shirt, a pair of pants and drawers, and a hat. But not his hat. It was his housekeeper's hat. A black hat trimmed with black ribbon with 2 large feathers sticking out of it. And as Turnbull mounted his horse, Mary Cape would be the last person to ever see Robert Turnbull alive. The next morning, 2 boys discovered a dead man lying up against a levee under the Macy Street Bridge. It was Robert Turnbull. Turnbull had a stroke, fell off of his horse, and ended up face down in the LA River. His stroke was caused by a blood clot on his brain, a result of the blow he took to the head. After examining the body, Los Angeles County Coroner James Meredith told the press that Turnbull had been murdered. The question is, who murdered Robert Turnbull? There seems to be no record of any of this. And after all, Los Angeles was still the Wild West. A few months later, the Quakers heard of Turnbull's unfortunate death and named the canyon in his honor. And that's it. That's how the canyon got its name. Turnbull Canyon, as we know it today, is a scenic wildlife oasis surrounded by a cityscape and suburban homes. People visit it every day for hiking, biking, and even a little storytelling. But even if all the canyon's truths are told, you will no doubt hear the echoes and whispers of new myths and legends for years to come. Today, Robert Turnbull himself has become a forgotten tale. But his story bridges the gap between two communities that otherwise have very little in common. He wasn't a founding father or a notable leader. He was a Scottish immigrant with a dream. His name lives on in both communities as they share the canyon that bears his name. Turnbull Canyon. Granite spars are standing all around. I tell you folks, it's heaven to be riding down the trail when the desert sun goes down.
Sagebrush everywhere, granite spires are standing all around. I tell you folks, it's heaven to be riding down the trail when the desert sun goes down.
Tours of the Jonathan Bailey House are available. Please call the Whittier Historical Society or visit their website for tour information. Tours of the Workman Temple Homestead in the City of Industry are available. Please call the Homestead Museum or visit their website for tour information. Getting to the bottom of a story or myth can be an adventure in itself. If you have a mystery you would like to solve, I suggest you find out for yourself. Discover the information you're looking for at your local library today.